Okay. Okay, so thank you for letting me speak here, even if the last speaker. But the first thing, I would like to thank the organizers, and I think everybody here will join in saying thank you to the organizers. So they really did a wonderful job. And I know that it's running a two-week conference workshops, winter school is not easy, it takes a lot of work. So thank you. And so you had 2 weeks of higher structure, so this will be also much easier and on much more ground level. There won't be anything very high about it. But on the other hand, there will be some analysis here. So you heard something about Banach spaces, of course, over non-Archimedean fields. This will be everything over complex numbers. And everything I'll say is joint work with Jens Card. And it's basically two papers which should show up on the archive next week. So the one thing that's missing are two introductions. Kind of introduction. So basic data. So basic data we're working with is, actually we are trying to think about generalizing notions from a single operator and to end up with commuting operators. You will see it as, say, think about the complex variety. So we have end up with commuting operators on a Hilbert space. And it's an old story due to Taylor's the generalization of various generalizations of the notion of spectrum of something like this. So like a single operator has spectrum, essential spectrum. If one defines for commuting n-tuple, the spectrum is follows. So look at the causal complex of the corresponding n-tuple. Well, you know what causal complex is here, so I don't have to explain it for a change. And given n-tuple A1, AN, A minus lambda is n-tuple A1 minus lambda 1, ... AN minus lambda N. So for n-tuple of complex numbers, we can look at this causal complex, and spectrum of A, n-tuple A is set of points in CN such that this complex is not acyclic. There's a couple more notions of spectrum. So Fredholm spectrum is a set of lambdas for which the corresponding boundary operator in the causal complex is Fredholm. So K-theory. So a Fredholm operator on a Hilbert space is one which has finite dimensional kernel and co-kernel. And we have an operator on a Hilbert space given here. Opposite to Fredholm spectrum, there's the essential spectrum. It's set of points lambda where this operator is not Fredholm. In particular, this is a subset of the spectrum. General facts. This spectrum of n-tuple is a closed subset of CN. You have basically no information about it. It can be anything, except that it's bounded, non-empty. Essential spectrum is a closed subset of a spectrum. You'll get some examples in a minute. And you can get examples where everything happens, whatever you want. So what Taylor did actually, the whole point was to do holomorphic functional calculus. Like given an operator on a Hilbert space, one takes four functions which is holomorphic in the neighborhood of the spectrum of this operator, and one takes this function of the operator. So more generally, for any function which is holomorphic in the neighborhood of the spectrum, one can construct the corresponding function evaluated at these operators A1 up to AN. And this is some kind of very fancy multivariable version of Cauchy formula. It's not easy, actually, but it works, and it gives a homomorphism from ring of these germs of holomorphic functions to bounded operators. Now, more or less statement of a problem. So let me formulate some questions. So suppose we have our n-tuple A, we look at n functions holomorphic in the neighborhood of a spectrum. So we can again form a, take functions of these A's. So we get again another n-tuple of commuting bounded operators. Okay. So the questions, and you see where they come from. The first question is, when is the corresponding complex Fredholm, Kossuth complex Fredholm? Suppose it is, what's its Fredholm index? And I do want somehow local notion of index here. And then if it's Fredholm, so we have a Fredholm operator, we can think about its determinant line. So we'll come back to determinant lines later. Well, you can't say very much about the determinant line, it's a complex line. But now we can try to compare two such determinant lines. So the concrete situation, suppose I have n minus one tuple and two more functions, then this is n tuple and this is n tuple, they are both Fredholm, so then I can try to compute determinant of this one divided by determinant of this one. So I've got two lines, and actually the quotient does give a number. I will come back, we'll be more precise a bit later. So the simple example, an example which comes, well, it's an old one. So to begin with, we take the Hilbert space of holomorphic L2 functions on the unit disk. Our operator, well, it's a single operator, it will be just multiplication by a complex coordinate. Spectrum of this operator is the closure of the unit disk. Fredholm spectrum is the complement of a boundary. So the essential boundary, essential spectrum of this operator is the boundary of the unit disk. And well, everybody knows actually that this operator is given any function f holomorphic in the neighborhood of the unit disk. You can take f of the Stieglitz operator. This is a Stieglitz operator associated to f. And this is Fredholm precisely when f does not vanish on the boundary. And if f does not vanish at the boundary, then the operator is Fredholm, has an index. Either you think of it as a winding number of f on the boundary, but you also have this local formula, just sum of multiplicities of zeros of f in the interior. So this is really a local formula. And we'll get to this one. And that's 1926 or something. So I think it's pretty old result. But then we are back in 1980s. So now suppose we have these two Fredholm of f and g are such functions. Then we can try to look at the determinant of tf divided by determinant of tg and try to compute it. Well, there is a formula here which you should actually recognize. Everybody here has a tame symbol of a pair f comma g. Tame symbol as Delin wrote down. There is one thing about this formula. So if you look about it, you should ask the question. So I have product of values of f at zeros of g divided by product of values of g at zeros of f in the denominator. So the first question was, whenever one sees this, one should ask, why does it make sense? And actually it does make sense because we have these multiplicities here. So if there are common zeros in numerator and denominator, they do cancel. So the powers you end up with are the same, so they cancel. It's basically, well, we'll come back to that. Anyway, so that's a formula due to Karen Pinkus, and it was done in a bit different context, and we'll come back to that.
Yeah. F is holomorphic where?
We have both of them are holomorphic in the neighborhood of a unit disk.
Any neighborhood,
germ. Okay. So germs, right?
Yeah. Okay. So
an invertible on the boundary.
When you say Fredholm operators, they're not actually the difficult case of Fredholm.
No.
No, because the projection is like the identity.
Well, we are not a unit disk, so it's easy to be a Fredholm operator.
Yeah.
Right. So they are injective and well. Co-kernel is basically given by a winding number of f, right? Okay, so let's go to the, so there are these two things I want to think of. So this Fredholmness index, I want this local index, and then I want to do something with determinant. So the index was actually well studied, and there is this general theorem due to various people who said the first one was Fritz Noether. But I think this particular form is due to those three gentlemen who wrote basically at the same time. And as follows, so suppose we have this n-tuple A, and we have n-tuple functions, g1, gn. Then this n-tuple ga is Fredholm precisely if set of zeros of ga does not intersect the essential spectrum of our n-tuple A. So just might be slightly confusing. So what I have, so think of g as a map from some neighborhood of spectrum to n to cn. Okay, so g inverse is pretty much of zero. And it's not supposed to, so this sits in cn. And so preimage of zero should not intersect the essential spectrum. And in this case, the index actually is written as a sum of local terms. One looks at set of zeros of G, so preimage of zero inside the spectrum, and one sums up over degree of the zero of G, so multiplicity of a zero times index of n-tuple A at the corresponding point lambda. So you really get, it's basically the same formula as the one we had before. So the same as this one here. So but I did want something local, right? So the formula itself is kind of push forward of Euler characteristic or something, the way it's proved. So, and I did want somehow meaning to these local terms. So they actually have very nice meaning, and it's as follows. So we can actually localize our situation. So remember that we have our Hilbert space, and all holomorphic functions on neighborhood of the spectrum act as operators on our Hilbert space. So we pick up element point in the spectrum, look at the corresponding ideal of functions vanishing at this point, and we can localize our Hilbert space at this point. And and we can, in fact, compute the local Euler characteristic, where HP lambda, just localization of our Hilbert space at this ideal. Assuming Fredholmness, everything here is finite dimensional, there are finite sums, so everything's well defined. So in particular, index, the formula, is sum of indices of these terms here, which we can just define as local indices. So basic technical exercise. This is really technical exercise, which is not that easy, maybe. So these localized homology groups here, they're actually not just modules over O lambda, over O A, so this funny ring of functions holomorphic in the neighborhood of a spectrum. They are, for each lambda, they actually become modules over the ring of power series convergent in the neighborhood of this point. Okay, so there's much stronger localization that one would expect. So I did write it. So this ring of functions in the neighborhood of the spectrum sits in the ring of power series convergent in the neighborhood of the point, and everything acts consistently. If you use this action, you can just think about, so in general, think about n-tuple GA, look at its homology, look at its homology, and then look at A1, AN as acting on homology. So here we get n-tuple of commuting, matrices acting on finite dimensional vector spaces. So there's this old Lie theorem which tells you that your finite dimensional vector space splits into a space of, eigenspaces. So characters of this one. And each of these blocks, so each of these blocks here coming in is just one of the blocks showing up here, and the action of our whole ring on one, And the action of the whole ring on one of the blocks is actually action by upper triangular matrix with constant value on the diagonal. So the conclusion from that is really as follows. So suppose G of A is Fredholm and lambda is point zero point of G. Then corresponding local homology groups are finite dimensional, and the index of these local homology groups is given by our pointwise formula. So basically, well, we had this 1 hour lecture about residues, right? So it's basically residue of point lambda. But of course, residue dependent on our original n-tuple. So that was the short part, so history. So the other story was determinants, or rather the other steps. So somehow it's one, so index is something of degree zero, determinants is something of degree one. What's happening afterwards, I don't know. So let's go to determinants. So some, and let's, well, you heard a lot of higher structures, but let's do things easily. Okay, so elementary things. So if you've got one of these Fredholm operators, so remember that kernel and co-kernel are finite dimensional, so you can write down this line, this complex one-dimensional vector space. So take top exterior power of the kernel, tensor top exterior power of the co-kernel. So what do we know? So this, well, this is a continuous line bundle of a space of Fredholm operators. So space of Fredholm operators has topology, norm topology, and in this norm, this is continuous line bundle. Actually, you can give space of Fredholm operators holomorphic structure, analytic structure, and this will be analytic bundle, actually. Moreover, so the basic property of determinant is that if you've got a finite, so short exact sequence of finite dimensional vector spaces, then the sequence gives an isomorphism, determinant isomorphism. So from determinant of a thing in the middle to determinant of the two things on both sides. Well, I will need to formalize things. We already heard something about Picard category, but let's, of a ring, but let's say we are at the moment with complex numbers. So the Picard category would be category of lines. So object appears L is line. So one-dimensional complex vector space, n is a number, integer. The morphisms are degree zero invertible linear transformations between complex lines. It's symmetric monoidal category. The tensor product is just the tensor product of the lines. We add the degrees. The symmetry operation is given by flipping of the tensor product where the sign shows up. Unit element is just trivial, so trivial line, degree zero, and the inverse is given by taking a joint and changing the sign. And more generally, so these are lines. So given a vector space placed to some degree n, just we define determinant of this vector space as either top dimension of B if n is even, or the dual to it if n is odd. And determinant of zero vector space is our line, our trivial line. So if we look at the category of bounded complexes of finite dimensional vector spaces, and we keep quasi-isomorphisms as morphisms, then we get a determinant functor. So from finite complex of vector spaces to category of Picard lines, we just given complex write down just product of the corresponding determinants of homology. Same thing you can do if we work with category of finite Fredholm complexes. Remember, we actually started with this Fredholm complex in the beginning, so that's what we are interested in. So, sorry, that went away. So given a Fredholm complex, so Fredholm means really that range of each of these boundary maps is closed, and if a finite codimension of a in the kernel of the next one, then we just, look at this category. This is, in fact, triangulated category sheet. This is a sheet of grading, mapping cone. You know what a mapping cone is here. Then triangulated, we have a corresponding exact triangles. So for each morphism, we get the corresponding exact triangle. And what happens here is that given an exact triangle like that, it induces an isomorphism from determinant of CF to determinant of B, tensor determinant of A shifted by 1. So actually, if we look at Fredholm complexes, then when I write determinant, I write, think about determinant of a homology of a complex. So homology of a complex is a bunch of finite-dimensional vector spaces, so determinant makes sense. Okay? Okay, now I wrote there's this natural isomorphism warning. For things to work, there are problems with signs, and basically everybody who writes things about determinants has different signs, and most of these signs don't match together. Okay, this is a signs in the subject are a real problem. Okay, so examples. Right, easy, very easy example. So remember, so I have this F from A to B. I'm looking at the corresponding exact triangle and asking what is the determinant, right? So suppose A and B are the same, right? Then I have isomorphic map from determinant of a mapping cone to determinant A, tensor determinant B shifted by 1. But both two are inverses of each other. So it's natural isomorphic to C. So in this case, this determinant, my mapping cone triangle, gives trivialization of a determinant of a mapping cone. So I get from determinant of CF to, sorry, to trivial line. Now, suppose moreover that F is a quasi-isomorphism. So mapping cone is, well, is homotopic to zero. So its homology is zero. So its determinant of zero is the trivial line. So what I get is a map from, well, complex numbers to complex numbers. Well, it's a number, right? So a linear map from complex numbers to complex numbers is a multiplication by a complex number. So it is a complex number, right? So and determinant, because it is actually a determinant, right? So our F consists of a bunch of FKs here. So we go down to cohomology and homology, and then we just multiply determinants.
Don't you mean cohomology, the induced map of F to N and 2N plus 1 on the cohomology of A?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, so that's just an abbreviation.
Just abbreviation, oh, right? It's just, I didn't want it to be too large, but no, it's just abbreviation. It's really on the level of cohomology. So the determinant A is really means determinant of a cohomology of a complex. Well, we'll use it a bit later, right? So back to these quotient complexes. So remember, I wanted to look at what happens when I have things acting on each other, right? So now suppose I have n minus 1 tuple and a couple more elements in our ring. By the way, it's a very strange ring. It's almost impossible to say anything about it. It can be as nasty as you want. Okay? So suppose I've got this n minus tuple and a couple more elements. So, well, we can try to look at the quotient complex associated to n plus 1 elements. Well, this quotient complex, is, you can think of it as, quotient complex by itself is just a bunch of mapping cones. Mapping cones of mapping cones of mapping cones, right? So you can think of it either as a mapping cone of F acting on the quotient complex of H, G on itself, or you can think of it as a mapping cone of G of A acting on quotient complex of H, F on itself, right? So, so our example here, that one, A equals B, then this exact triangle gives a trivialization of the determinant of mapping cone. So actually I have two triangles. The one associated to a CF gives a trivialization. Trivialization of this total mapping cone. So isomorphism to C. And also the other triangle gives me another trivialization of the same thing. Okay? So I have two trivializations of the same line. Well, let's define the torsion of the n plus one tuple to be composition. So I'm going this way. From C here equals this here. Again, there are signs coming up. So it looks simpler than it is because there are signs involved in these determinants. But in principle, that's over the modular signs.
So in principle, you're taking the ratio of two graded lines.
Yes.
So in principle, there could be an integer shift, but I think it's zero.
Yes, it could.
But it's zero.
It's zero, yeah. No. In principle, could be integer shift. No, in principle, not just in principle. So if you are not careful, you run into problem with signs to begin with, right? Not just integer shift, but signs as well. But there is no shift. Okay, so theorem. I didn't give any information. So let's state the result, right? So now suppose we are in this situation. So in this situation, when we have n plus one tuple, and some of them are, so we have n plus one tuple, and actually we assume that H1, Hn minus 1, comma F produce some Fredholm complex, H1, H minus, n minus 1, G produce Fredholm complex. So these are these two, So these are these two conditions for Fredholmness. Okay, so set of zeros of H, comma F does not intersect essential spectrum, and set of zeros of H, comma G does not intersect essential spectrum. Okay, then the torsion, as defined before, is given by this formula, so it should remind you very much about this. Well, it is basically Denis Tate's Thames symbol. So again, we have value, except that now we sit on actually on a variety of zeros of H. So you have this complex curve, highly singular actually in general. And so we are sit with H is zero, and then just look at value of F at zeros of G, and divide by values of G at zeros of F. Okay. The sign is a global sign which depends on global index of the two complexes. Two comments. So comment number one. So if there are no common zeros, then I said if there are no common zeros for H, F, and G, then this is a trivial complex. So quotient complex of the whole n plus one tuple is trivial, so it's contractible. So actually both this number and this number are already given as numbers. So the quotient is a quotient of the corresponding numbers. So and the number here is just, remember, it was just the determinant of this F. So F acting on cohomology of H, comma G, and the other one was the other determinant. Now, if we remember this basic technical result, once we localize things, all our functions act as upper triangular matrices with constant values on the diagonal. So, formula like, so these are values on the diagonal, this is the size of a diagonal. So that's not surprising. So this is not surprising, and the quotient is the quotient. Now, do I have anything else here? Yeah, so I wrote it here, actually. So again, if there are no common zeros, this one is contractible. So determinant is just determinant of F acting here, and the set it's upper triangular matrices with constant diagonals, you get the formula. Now, general case, so you know, so the problem here is, of course, what happens when we have joint zero, lambda equals mu. Okay, so in one-dimensional case, in the case when we were working with a disk, there was this miracle. Disk is a one-dimensional smooth complex curve, so at any point there is uniformizing variable. So this kind of expressions, you do L'Hopital rule, the Euler and I don't know, first year calculus. and this makes sense, right? Now we are somewhere on some, well, it's still complex curve, except that it's highly singular. It's actually sub-analytic, not even algebraic. So that's because of the problem of the size of how the spectrum looks like, right? So we can't consider very much. Still, this formula, well, if I write this as it is, it doesn't really make sense, but what really makes sense is, well, once there's a perturbation formula, so just move lambda and mu slightly, so you move f and g slightly, so that they do not have a chain zero, compute this number and take the limit. And this works because of, well, a bit surprising fact, but it wasn't easy to prove, which is somehow basis of this formula. So we have this joint torsion, which goes, actually maybe I should state it slightly differently. So I'll just write.